Hey guys, today we're going to be installing headrest screens into this 2014 Ram. So you want to entertain your rear passengers. There are a variety of ways we can do this. We can either add an overhead monitor, we can do headrest screens. I've even seen products where you can do mounts for iPads and things like that. So today we're going to be doing a traditional headrest screen upgrade. Now, the reason why we want to do this one is this is actually the least invasive install as far as modifying your vehicle. Whenever you do a overhead, you typically have to cut the or modify the headliner to get it in there. And if you were to take it down, you're going to be left with holes or modifications. In today's install, we're actually not modifying the factory headrest at all, even though this aftermarket one looks a lot like the factory one. Another reason we are going with the headrest screens is it's going to allow us to have each passenger on the left and the right of the vehicle to actually choose what they want to do individually. Also, this vehicle has a sunroof, so you'd have to bring the overhead quite far back to actually make it install properly. So for this customer, this is what's going to work best for them. So here we have the factory headrest and here we have the aftermarket one. Now obviously the aftermarket one's gonna have a bit of a different shape to it because we have to fit more components inside of it. But you can see here, it is actually matched to the factory one. The materials look very similar stitching. So obviously on the factory one, we don't have any screen. And typically what you'd have to do is you'd have to cut an X, remove the foam, put in your assembly, drop everything down. And the thing is though, sometimes you couldn't get the wiring inside the tube, so you'd have to run it on the outside. So here is our housing on the aftermarket one. The stitching again continues to the back, so it looks really factory. It's significantly deeper, obviously, to house everything, the DVD player and the screen. And the tubes that actually attach to the back of to the actual seat are big enough to run wiring inside. So when we make adjustments, we don't actually see any wire. It's gonna look very factory afterwards. Right now I am assembling the headrest, and what I really like about this Rosen setup is everything is modular. So if you ever had to service something, you can actually take out pieces individually and replace them. So you can see here, here's the DVD drive, and I have the screen separately, and we have to assemble everything in order. So if you ever had a bad DVD drive, you could probably just order a new DVD drive as opposed to ordering a whole headrest assembly, which I've seen some manufacturers do where they just encase everything. You can see here our wiring goes in, lots of clearance. Coming through here, coming out the tubes. So you get a very nice clean installation. On this assembly, everything snaps in. There's no screws that are used to hold this assembly together. So when you're pushing on the LCD screen, only push on the frame. This thing tilts on here for adjustability. Do not put your hand, don't try to put your whole hand on it and push it in. Don't use your thumb, that's even worse. If you're gonna reduce your surface area, don't touch the screen at all. Use the frame to push it in and make sure it clicks in. I'm not gonna click it in all the way, I'm just having it in snug so I can go ahead and test everything, double check. I know I have the DVD in the right orientation, but in case for whatever reason I had it backwards, at least I can pop it out easy, because once this clicks in, it's a little bit difficult to take it apart. Now I'm beginning to wire up the seat. Now before you get started, pull the headrest out, and on this case, no matter what the seat is, you have to check for obstructions for the wiring. We do have an airbag in here, you can see there's the label right here, so it is something to be cautious about. So you're gonna take off both sides of the back of the seat, so we got some of it out right now, and then you're gonna inspect everything inside, run your wiring. You also wanna leave a little bit of a service loop, so leave some slack. Don't make it super tight, because if you have the headrest in the lowest position, make this super tight, and then you try to make an adjustment on the headrest, what's gonna happen is it's gonna pull in the wiring. So when running the cabling for the seat, we have to leave lots of slack, because you have to consider that the seat goes back and forth. The other thing too is, run underneath the track. Now what you can do, when you look underneath these power seats, you'll actually see another harness because it has the control of the seats, the airbags, everything. So you can just follow that. We're lucky enough that it actually comes from the center console. I have it out here so you guys can see. I have it loomed so it looks factory. It's going to add another layer of protection, helps hold everything together. I shrink tube and Tesla taped it all together. It's still relatively serviceable. We don't always have to unplug this, so I decided to put the shrink tube on there to help hold it together. Then I'm going to tuck this way back so we don't see it, and it's going to look like a factory piece or harness. With our wiring laid out the way we wanted, we're just going to go ahead and test the seat and see how it flows with the factory wiring, but we know that works okay. We'll bring it back. looking really good. So it doesn't pull or anything, doesn't get in the way of any other mechanical parts, so it's not gonna get damaged. We can go ahead and keep wiring this up. So we have all our wiring hooked up to our AV control module, and we also have it powered up. Now, this only pulls at a maximum of 7.5 amps, and it also has the ability to have a charging cable, which I'm gonna show you guys afterwards. I could just wire it directly up to this, the back of the power adapter or cigarette adapter over here, but I'm not sure if the customer's ever gonna add a bunch of other devices on the front, and then we might be stressing out the circuit quite a bit. So what I'm doing is, because I have power and ground up here, I'm actually using it to trigger my relay, which is down mounted over here. That way it's, you know, I actually mounted it so it looks like it's supposed to be there. It's gonna be reliable, tucked out of the way. Why'd I use a relay? Because then I can go into a thicker wire, find it somewhere in the truck, and then that will actually drive my device. Not that way I'm not stressing out the factory circuitry so much. The other thing is, on these newer trucks, everything's controlled through the controlled area network bus system, or CAN bus. I caution you, don't hook up to anything on here, especially these push to start vehicles. It's very sensitive electronics. You're not going to find enough amperage what you're looking for. The whole purpose why they're doing this is because copper is very expensive. They're using much higher voltage and they're trying to use less amperage running through these lines. So stay away from stuff like this. In some cases, on some of these newer vehicles, you might have to run the wire all the way out to the battery and then use relays inside to power up aftermarket devices. So the installer in me wants to take the factory head unit out and coil the FM output for the module. Instructions clearly say not to do that. So because the antenna mast is on this side, what I've done is I've actually loomed that wire. It's just one strand of wire, and I've loomed it. And I am running it here with as much of the factory wiring as I can, and I'm going as near to the factory antenna as described in the instructions. As you can see, I have the module down there so we don't have any clearance problems, and over here we're gonna have everything integrated with the factory wiring. Everything's run with the factory wiring, that way we're not gonna have any reliability issues over time. We now have our HDMI and USB charging station or plug right over here, flush mounted into the factory location right underneath the factory power plug over here. And to do that easily, I just use a giant step-up bit. Now we can test. I've tested everything on the bench, but we're going to obviously test again when we're in the vehicle. So we're just going to power on the screens. So they first start up on the DVD player. Now I have a disc in this guy. They actually both have DVD players in them, which is the cool thing. So we're going to let this guy load up. So here's the cool thing I like about these screens with that module. So you can see that we have something going on here. Let's say both passengers in the back want to watch the same thing, but you only have one DVD. We can just go ahead and change the source, and it can piggyback off of it, and it can go vice versa. So that's the really cool thing about here. Obviously, we also have our headphones, so we don't have to listen through the speakers if we don't want to. We can hook up virtually anything to this system. We could either have like a gaming system on here. Anything that will work on AV or even HDMI is going to work on here. And here's how the DVD loads. So we have to have the label facing out and it top loads in. I have to say, I really like these headrests. You can see here, just looking at it, everything just matches the material, the stitching. It looks like it came from the factory with this truck, which it didn't. It's a purely aftermarket piece. So if you have a pickup or a car or SUV that you don't have headrest screens and you're looking for it, I would definitely look into the Rosen brand and get these matched ones and just order it however your vehicle's interior is. So what do you guys think? If you were going to do a rear entertainment solution, would you pick something like this or would you prefer an overhead? Comment below. If you like today's content, make sure to check out my channel and hit the subscribe button and make sure to hit that bell notification. What that does is it makes sure that you're always kept up to date with all the content that we're providing with you guys on YouTube. So the way that we have the channel set up is I have the uploads up top. That way, at all times, you can always see, if you just hop by the channel, what our latest upload is. Plus, with the bell notification, you're going to get some sort of message from YouTube itself. We also have popular uploads, car car videos, how-to videos, demonstration, informational videos, and a lot of cool other specific car videos like our builds playlist. I really like the builds playlist because it takes all the theories from our how-to section and it keeps applying it to different vehicles.